Tragedies mar the observance of the Holy Week in the Philippines. Authorities recorded over a dozen deaths, 19 of which are drowning incidents, including an 8-year-old in Leyte. The Calabarzon region saw the highest number of fatalities, with 7 deaths reported. Meanwhile, separate vehicular accidents killed 2 people in Bulacan, while 2 more were injured in Region 5. The PNP also documented other incidents, including robbery, homicide, and fire in other parts of the country. Pope Francis calls for an immediate ceasefire in Gaza and the release of all Israeli hostages as he presides over the Easter Sunday Mass at St. Peter's Square. The Pope's Easter message traditionally focuses on world affairs, and he marked the most important day on the Christian calendar by deploring the suffering caused by wars. The pontiff also mentioned other flashpoints, including Ukraine, Syria, Lebanon, Myanmar, and Haiti.
My thoughts go especially to the victims of the many conflicts worldwide, beginning with those in Israel and Palestine and in Ukraine. May the risen Christ open a path of peace for the war-torn peoples of those regions. May the risen Christ open a path of hope to all those who in other parts of the world are suffering from violence, conflict, food insecurity, and the effects of climate change. May the Lord grant consolation to the victims of terrorism in all its forms.
The Pope has been in poor health in recent weeks, but took part in some Holy Week events. After the service, the pontiff also took time to greet the massive crowd that had gathered at the Vatican. The Philippines moving to boost its maritime security amid China's aggressive actions. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. signed an executive order creating the National Maritime Council, which will be led by Executive Secretary Lucas Bersamin. The council will be composed of several government agencies, including the National Security Council and the Department of National Defense. It will be responsible for formulating policies and strategies to ensure the country's maritime security and domain awareness. The latest move came days after Beijing's back-to-back maritime attacks, injuring 3 Filipino soldiers and a group of Filipino scientists conducting maritime research in the West Philippine Sea. Despite the Pope's plea, there seems to be no let-up in Israel's offensive. The Israeli military claims to have killed a Hezbollah commander as it releases a video of airstrikes in several locations inside Lebanon. It identifies the target as Ismail al-Zin, a commander in the anti-tank missile unit of Hezbollah's Radwan forces. He is said to be responsible for dozens of attacks on Israeli civilians, communities, and security forces. Meanwhile, Gaza health officials and Hamas media report an Israeli airstrike hit several tents inside the Al-Aqsa hospital, killing 4 people and injuring several others, including some journalists. The Israeli military says it carried out an airstrike against a command center of the Islamic Jihad. Israel has claimed hospitals in Gaza are used by Hamas and other militant groups as bases, which Hamas and medical staff deny. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to undergo hernia surgery Sunday. The procedure comes less than a year after he was fitted with a pacemaker. The hernia was discovered Saturday during a routine checkup, and the decision was made for the 74-year-old premier to undergo surgery after completing his daily schedule. Netanyahu's office says he is expected to make a full and quick recovery and will return to work soon after. Turkish President Tayyip Erdogan and his ruling party suffer a blow in nationwide local elections, as Istanbul Mayor Ekrem İmamoğlu cements his standing as a chief future rival. With more than half of votes counted, İmamoğlu leads by nearly 10 percentage points in the mayoral race in Istanbul. The 52-year-old is again poised to defeat Erdogan's chosen candidate, despite a concerted effort to unseat him. Nationwide, the opposition CHP party is leading by almost 1% of the votes, a first in 35 years. Erdogan's disappointing showing could signal a change in Turkey's divided political landscape. Sunday's election took place amid rampant inflation and massive devaluation of lira. Erdogan has acknowledged the results and has marked a turning point for his party, but promised to respect the decision of the nation. At least 7 children wounded in a shooting in downtown Indianapolis. The ages of the victims range from 12 to 17. Authorities say they heard several shots being fired late Saturday evening near the Circle Central Mall. They rushed to the scene and found a group of juveniles, including 6 of the victims. All of the victims are now in stable condition. No suspects have been arrested, but investigators believe more than one weapon was used. The shooting came as Indianapolis continues to grapple with a steady rise in gun violence.
This is the third weekend in a row that something like this has happened, a mass event. Is there anything that's going to be done to prevent something like this?
Of course, we're always out trying to prevent something like this. This evening, we had over 25 officers in a mile square area of downtown actively trying to prevent this type of activity from happening. Downtown Commander Burton has already changed resources and directed resources to try to address these juvenile crowds before they get started, and having officers that come in earlier even to try to address that and stay on top of it. So absolutely, all of our resources are going to be directed at preventing this kind of crime.
Maryland Governor Wes Moore urges Republicans in Congress to work with Democrats in approving the federal funding needed to rebuild the bridge in Baltimore. Moore says rebuilding the bridge will get the state's port economy back on its feet. The Biden administration has released $60 million in initial emergency aid to assist in cleanup efforts and help speed up the reopening of the port. But at least $2 billion are needed to rebuild the Francis Scott Key Bridge. The bridge collapsed last week, killing 6 road workers when a container ship lost power and crashed into a support pylon. The port has been closed since, leaving in limbo the jobs of some 15,000 people. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to our friends at The Rundown. Here are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region.
We begin with Pope Francis breaking tradition by washing the feet of women only during the special annual service emphasizing humility. The 87-year-old pontiff, who recently limited his speaking engagements due to health issues, washed and kissed the feet of 12 women inmates at Rome's Rebibbia prison. The ritual, which takes place on Thursday before Easter, is meant to imitate Jesus Christ's washing of his disciples' feet the night before his death. Francis is the first pope to hold the foot-washing ceremony outside churches, usually in prisons, homes for the elderly, or hospices. He began this practice when he was Archbishop of Buenos Aires.
This is our warehouse. We store the plywood.
We go to New Jersey, where we meet 72-year-old Filipina Lita Marcelo Abel, who is at the helm of a multi-million-dollar enterprise as President and Chief Executive Officer of U.S. Lumber, a building supplies business established by her husband in 1974. Today, U.S. Lumber is an industry leader in specialty plywood and building products in the tri-state area.
I always wants to be, you know, a boss or my own business, things like that. And I'm dreaming and dreaming and dreaming. And I never thought that my dream will come true.
Marcelo Abel is giving back by helping young women achieve their own dreams with an initial $10,000 endowment scholarship to the Roman College of Southern Jersey.
What we hope will happen, other businesses, other women who lead businesses will speak to our students, mentor our students, encourage them, scholarship opportunity, but hopefully and possibly other donors will now come to the table.
And finally, we head to the annual Haru Matsuri Festival, hosted by the Japanese Canadian Cultural Center in Toronto, where attendees were immersed in a vibrant celebration of culture performances and activities. Among those are the graceful hula performances by seniors, guided by Filipino hula teacher Renee Siao, who has been teaching at the center for over a decade, advocating for good health and fostering camaraderie.
I've seen my children dance, and I enjoy it. And also the camaraderie, and of course, it gets me out of the house.
Upon migrating from Quezon City, Philippines to Toronto in 1978, Xiao, who learned hula as a kid, decided to start a small class in her apartment, which grew from six kids to thousands of students across all ages, some of whom have carried on her legacy.
Hula gave them the discipline and it taught them the teamwork. I will highly recommend that they should be taking these classes because of what they can benefit and learn from being involved in a hula community.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News. Log on to the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel and download the ABS-CBN News app for your smartphones and tablets. I'm TJ Manato. Back to our friends at the Rundown.
Oh, the latest installment in the Godzilla X Kong Monsters saga has arrived. But is it worth the trip to the cinemas? Here's the verdict of Manny the Movie Guy.
Previously on this Monsterverse,
the Titans were the guardians of nature, and the great apes became the protectors of humanity.
But then, this sequel to 2021's Godzilla vs. Kong follows the giant monsters as they unite together to battle not one, but two enemies.
Something even they're afraid of.
Action. From director Adam Wingard, the guy who gave us Godzilla vs. Kong, the filmmaker seems to take inspiration from the Godzilla movies from the 60s and 70s, less on the plot and more on the monster action.
I just love the sequences where the monsters are interacting with each other.
And there's a lot of monster interactions with this one, with many scenes having no dialogues as they focus on the monsters, which is really fine, for the spoken word here is laughably horrendous.
Godzilla won't come down here unless Kong brings him.
As expected, the humans take a backseat for the monsters to shine, so actors like Dan Stevens, Rebecca Hall, and Brian Tyree Henry are used just to move the plot forward and to say horrible lines.
They're beloved and they're literally larger than life, which is cinema itself.
Yes, this movie is big, but it's only made for those who love their Titans clash. But for those who love meaningful plots against the monster mash like Godzilla Minus One, you're out of luck. Just leave your brain out the door and embrace your inner Titan. And for Godzilla fans, you may be disappointed that your giant lizard is just a supporting player to Kong's emotional journey. Kong is king in this story. The special effects are okay, but the cinematography and editing are way too busy to sit still and focus, especially during the fight scenes. Too exhausting.
It was almost the end of Kong.
So word of caution, if you're looking for giant monster shows with affecting storyline and intelligent human characters, you're better off watching Apple TV's Monarch: Legacy of Monsters. This new empire is unapologetically monster-centric, and if you're okay with that, then this film is for you. It's a fun pre-summer blockbuster film that displays its badge with pride and honor. And for that, Godzilla X Kong, the new empire, gets 2.5 out of 4 roar kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ANC.
Oh, here's a glimpse of how Easter was celebrated in other parts of the world. In Germany, hopes and eggs flew high at the 36th Easter egg throwing contest. Nearly 300 people participated with the goal of sending the eggs flying without breaking their shells. The farthest egg reached 55 meters, still short of the 73-meter record. Over in Paris, the Olympics fever is running high as traditional Easter chocolate eggs embraced a sports theme. Chocolates molded as egg-shaped track athletes and timers, podiums and medals adorned stores in anticipation of the Games, which will run from July 26 to August 11. And in Belgium, thousands of Antwerp residents came together to celebrate both the Muslim Iftar and Christian Easter by sharing a meal on a 2-kilometer-long table. The event broke the record for the longest community dinner table in Belgium. But beyond that feat, the initiative wants to promote connection among cultures and religions in a time of tensions across the globe.
We try to bring people together. It's about fasting, so we try to start from something that they share to use like the different diversity in religion, in culture, to bring people together and to enjoy each other's holidays.
There's so much war and trouble over the whole world, and we are a very nice example of it can go also in a different way.
It's like good to bring people together from different cultures and like learn about each other in like a way, like eating is like a social event, so I think it's like very nice.